Oh, it was so good this morning as we had Bible class and Brother Truett Adair spoke to us, encouraging us and letting us know what was happening throughout Cuba and throughout the world also with those solar players that we have been involved in and helping and purchasing, and he's been distributing. And it's just wonderful that that is continuing to be used and it will continue to be used for years and years, and no telling what good can be done through these. How many lives will be touched and how many lives will be changed because we took a position and said we want to help and helped in that. And it's just so, so encouraging to hear that the word is preached and received in Cuba and that there are those churches being planted all over Cuba. Isn't that wonderful? It's just never thought we'd see the day when it would happen. And it is happening, and we are a part of that through Brother Truett and in the area that he helps in that. Open your books to or your Bibles to Mark chapter 2, and we'll be reading there and talking about a certain incident it was, and we had a little inkling of that as we had in our scripture reading, about an occasion, whenever it was, that a man was let down through the roof, because he could not enter in through the doors, and he wanted to be changed by Jesus. Now, wouldn't it be wonderful, it is, as we are here on Sunday morning, that people would say, we can't even get into the building to hear Jesus. And I hope that I preach Jesus, and that's what you expect me to do, and that's what I expect to do. But we have thousands upon thousands sitting at home, not interested in hearing about Jesus, not interested in that being a part of their lives, not interested in Jesus changing their lives, anything, just satisfied in saying, you know, I like my life the way that it is, and I'll just continue living this way. And their lives need to be touched, and their lives need to be changed. And maybe it is that we can be inspired through this morning to go out and touch someone's life, because you see, they can't see Jesus, but they can see you, and they can see Jesus in you. And so it is, we read the occasion, what did Jesus see? Now, I'm sure if you went and you talked to the people that were there and you asked them, what did you see? And the people would come from the house and they say, well, we saw a man raised who could not walk. We heard great things. No man ever spoke like this before. We saw the Messiah, the Anointed One. And you would get different accounts of what they saw. But I want to look at, what did Jesus see? When he was there in that house in Capernaum, his hometown, what did he see? Think about that. We're going to focus in on Mark 2, verses 3 through 5, and I'm going to read these again. And they came unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, and he was born of four. When they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. First of all, I emphasize the word they. I can't imagine it was, as Jesus is speaking, as I'm speaking now, and he's speaking to the people, and they were thrown and pressed around and such that, and then all of a sudden they heard a noise. Now we hear different noises from time to time. Sometimes a cell phone goes off. Sometimes a kid goes off. And sometimes, it, you know, things happen and whatever it is. But can you imagine that we hear a noise from above and all of a sudden, you know, dirt and debris begins to fall down and the ceiling opens? Maybe some of it falls down. Maybe not. But all of a sudden we look up and you see these four guys and they begin letting one down. And Jesus looked up and he saw them. Now, I know he saw the one being let down, but he saw them. And then the next verses it says, and Jesus seeing their faith, those four were not going to let obstacles get in the way of the one that they cared about being changed by Jesus. They couldn't get into doors. There was a crowd there. They came through the roof. Wouldn't it be wonderful if people today said, I'm not going to let anything stop me from Jesus changing my life. You know, there at Hampton, they meet an hour earlier than everyone else. They meet at 9 o'clock instead of 10 o'clock. I have to get up an hour earlier to be there. But you know what? I'm not going to let that stop me from being here. I'm going to be here. I don't care what time they meet. I've got to drive from all the way across town. We've got people that are driving some great distance to come here. I'm not going to let that stop. Well, I've got to get the kids ready. Then I got to get my husband ready, right? Wives, and say, you know. And so I'm not going to let that stop. You know, Mom and Daddy, I've told this story before. We got ready for Sunday morning on Sunday night. We laid out our clothes. Mama wasn't going to have us going about, I can't find my socks or whatever, can't find my shirt. We laid out our clothes on Saturday night. We shined our shoes. You know, we had Sunday shoes. Shine those shoes on Saturday night, get ready for Sunday. Everything was laid out. Everything was ready. If it wasn't, you heard about it from Mama. Because she said, I want you to do it Saturday night and get ready. It's five kids. If we were not the first one at the building, we were late. You know, because it was during winter time that Daddy lit the heater. We didn't have central heat like this. And he'd light those two heaters on each side of the building up front. Get people sit down front if they want to get warm. Light them right up here. Someone else would come in and light the ones in the back. But Daddy lit the ones in the front. But it was that what is it that hinders us from being with Jesus? Is it too much to ask to come and to meet together in a building that is central heated, central air, with cushions? We didn't have cushions on the seat. We sang out of a song book. We didn't have we didn't have PowerPoint back then. And people, I saw a little video today of a virtual church. Now, a lot of you don't know what I'm talking about. A lot of you do know what I'm talking about. It was that you put on this contraption that, and you can see in there, and they go into virtual reality of whatever it is. You play games or whatever it is. They say, we're going to have a virtual church. You don't even have to leave your bed. You just put this on over your head, and you can participate in a worship service. You choose the type of preacher that you want. You want a preacher to preach on love? You push that button. You get one that, you know, you want a good hellfire and brimstone, you push on that button. Want to hear traditional songs? You push this button. We sing along with that. You don't even have to leave your bed. Have virtual church. Just send us your money, though. Yeah. Yo, is it too hard to come and be with Jesus this morning? What did Jesus see? Number one, he saw four men who cared. Isn't that right? They cared enough to said, we have something that we've got to do. We've heard that Jesus is here, and, you know, maybe he's been here in the past, and maybe they hadn't got a chance to see him. Maybe the crowd has been there in times. They said, this time it's going to happen that we've got a friend that needs Jesus. And we're not going to let anything stop. But they cared enough. They forgot about self. Let's look at a couple of verses with this. Forget about self. Matthew 16, verse 24 and following. If you look up Matthew 16, Jesus talks about deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. But I want to focus in. He said deny yourself. It's not about you. You know, when we come together and we worship, it's not about you. And we have people that go into worship services and say, I didn't get anything out of it. Well, you know what? It's not about you. It's about us coming to worship God. And it's all about God. If it's not, you're here for the wrong reason. But it's not about us. We deny ourselves. Church is no longer me, me, me. It's others, others, others. And that's when you get it right. All about others. Paul Paul would say in Philippians 1, he said, for me to live is Christ. You know, we deny ourselves. It's not our life. For me to live is Christ. Now, he's ascended back up into heaven, but he lives through us. That's what Paul would say. For me to live is as if Jesus would be here. What would he say? What would he do? Where would he go? That's what I want to do. All about others. They forgot self and helped others. They cared about others. You know, God cares. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God cares. And continues to care. 1 Peter 5, verse 7. Casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. He cares for you. He cares enough to not let anything stop him from caring for you. And then we must care also. In Luke chapter 10, it is that Jesus told us about who is my neighbor. He told the story about the Good Samaritan, about the man who came and fell among thieves, and he was laying half dead by the side of the road, and the priest and Levite walk on by, and the Samaritan goes and stops and takes care of him and binds up his wounds and takes him to the inn and says, whatever cost it is that he incurs, I will come back and take care of that. He cared for a perfect stranger. He didn't know the person. He didn't know what his background was. He didn't know what his future was. He just knew he needed help. And he cared. And so these four said, I've got a friend. I assume he was a friend. He needed care. They cared enough to go the extra mile. He saw four men he cared. Then he saw four men who tried. They weren't going to let anything stop him, right? Four men who tried. He said, this is what we're going to do. And then maybe they got their heads together and they brought him there and they saw the crowd. They can't go through this door. And what are we going to do? They didn't give up. They said, this is going to happen. You go to 2 Kings, we know the story of the four lepers there. As a Syrian army had surrounded Jerusalem. And they said, they were outside the gate, and they said, you know, in 2 Kings there, they said, we're going to die. There's no food in the city, famine everywhere. There's no hope for us. Now what we can do, we can stay here and die, or we can go to the Syrians, and maybe it is that they put us to death, and we're going to die anyway, but maybe they'll feed us and take care of us. And so they went to the enemy's camp, and when they'd gotten there, it was completely empty. Everyone had left. They didn't know, but that night it was that God had caused such a noise that they said that the Israelites have gotten with other kings, with the Egyptians, and said that they have joined together and they're going to overpower us. And they heard this noise and they ran and left everything in the camp. And all the food was there. And boy, they began to eat and to feast. And then they said, you know, it's not about us. We've got all this. And we've got our friends and family back in the city starving. Let's go tell them the good news. And they did. Four men who tried. The only ability God really cares about, someone once said, I didn't come up with this, is availability. Do you really care for others? Or are you really going to not let any obstacle hinder you from doing what needs to be done? Are you available? Are you ready? Romans 8, verse 31 says, if God is for us, who can be against us? And we're on God's side, and we know what God's will is to be done, and we know what God's work is to be done, and who is it that's going to do it? Who is it that's going to try? Who is it that's going to step out if not us? And he calls upon us to go the extra mile and tear down the roof if it needs to be. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, he Paul said in Philippians 4, verse 13. To try, to be available, to say, here am I, send me, as Isaiah did in Isaiah 6. Four men who try. And then he saw four men who worked together. Isn't that wonderful? It took all four working together to let the man down evenly as he would be set down. Four men who worked together. Amos 3, verse 3 says, shall two walk together except they be agreed? You know, can we imagine what work can be done if we all but say we're going to be of a mind to work together? Ecclesiastes 4, verse 12 talks about that threefold cord. It's not easily broken because it is bound together. We know that cord, as you get a piece of rope, there are three ropes bound together in one to make one stronger than the three are individually. We're stronger together than we are separately. Psalm 133, verse 1, behold how pleasant, how good when brethren dwell together in unity. And how it is. God wants us to be one, united, together. Jesus prayed in John 17 that we may all be one as he and the Father were one. That we be one together. And he would say that we must be one. That the world may know that you sent me. And he said again in John 13, verse 34 and 35, a new commandment I give you, to love one another. To love one another. Care for one another. Help one another. By this, he said, shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And so working together. Being together, unified together. He saw four men who worked together. 1 Corinthians 12, 25 and 26 talks about the church being a body, like our body. Our body works together. It doesn't work against each other. The hand doesn't work against the feet or to accomplish a task. It doesn't work against the eyes. The eyes don't work. We all work together. We're one body. He saw four men who worked together. Then he saw four men who wanted to share Christ. Didn't that one? Someone once said, we'll not go to heaven alone. Think about that. If we go to heaven, we're carrying others with us. He also said, we're not going to hell alone either. And so we're leading one way or the other toward heaven, toward hell. And you think about those who shared Jesus with others. Andrew found Peter. Jesus found Philip, and Philip found Nathanael. In Acts chapter 4, first of all, we have the Samaritan woman. When Jesus talked to her by the well, and she went and told the city, come and hear the one who's told me everything. John 4. And then in Acts chapter 8. When persecution came upon the church, it said they went everywhere. Scattered abroad, went everywhere preaching the word. They didn't say, you know, if I were back home, then I'd preach about Jesus. But I'm out here in a new place among people I don't know. And so I'll just keep quiet. Now they went everywhere preaching the word. What did Jesus see? Saw four men that were not sick. Helping someone who was sick. I saw four men who didn't need Jesus physically, but this man needed to be healed, and they brought him and made a difference in his life. What did Jesus see? He also saw the throng of people that hindered these. He also saw the stumbling blocks, and if you're going to preach Jesus, you're going to have stumbling blocks. He saw the throng of the multitude who would not make way for the paralyzed man, but they brought him anyway. He saw the hypocrisy of the Jews who questioned him and said, "Only God can forgive sins." He said to the man, "Your sins are forgiven." You see, he saw their faith, and he said to the man, "Your sins are forgiven." And they said, "You can't forgive sins. Only God can." And I imagine Jesus went, "That's right. That's right. Only God can forgive sins. But to know that the Son of Man has power to forgive sins here on earth, take up your bed and walk." And he took up his bed and walked. Has Jesus changed your life? Don't you know that man could not keep quiet about Jesus for the rest of his life? Let me tell you about a day when my friend let me down and Jesus said, "Take up your bed and walk." Let me tell you about a day when my sins were forgiven. He started a spiritual walk that day. I imagine he did, didn't he? And he walked with the Lord from then on. What did Jesus see? Number one, he saw those who cared. He still needs people who care. He still needs people who try. He still needs people who are willing to work together. He still needs people who are willing to share Jesus with others. It made a difference in this man's life for the rest of his life. That's what happens when you share Jesus. I hope that we leave here and realize we are either the man in need of healing, or we are one of the friends helping someone who needs help. I hope we're not one of the ones who are the stumbling blocks in letting others get to Jesus. I hope we're not one of the ones who are the hypocrites who condemned him for doing the good that he did. Are we one of the four? Are we those who care, those who try, those who work together, and those who share? If not, as we start this new year, we need to see what Jesus saw. We need to look around and say, can we make a difference? Who can we help? If you need help more than just yourself, get some other people. Work together. We're doing the greatest work here on earth, which will live forever in eternity. Decide to share Jesus. It may be that there's someone here who has been thinking about being a Christian, and we offer the invitation every time we meet. What a great joy here on earth and joy in heaven would be that to someone come forward and say, I want to put on Christ in baptism. I want to become a Christian. I want to become a member here at Hampton and make this my church family. Oh, wonderful things. If you wish to respond to the gospel invitation, will you come right now while we stand and while we sing?